Welcome to The Secrets of Success. By following the proven techniques of the guests who appear on this series, you'll learn that even successful people run into detours and failures, and how you can apply their success techniques to change your life.
You're now listening to the most unique show on radio, the show dedicated to making you a success. The future of technology can be exciting or terrifying. Today, you'll find out why with our guest, Alex Salkever. Alex, thanks for being with us.
Thanks very much for having me on. I appreciate it.
Now, Alex, you have a very interesting book, and I'm going to warn our listeners, they're going to get taken into the very, very real future. But Alex's book is called The Driver in the Driverless Car. Now, can you explain that title? Yeah.
Well, I wish I could hold up the cover of the book so people could see it. On the cover, you see someone sitting in a car that looks like a Google car with the steering wheel, and they're facing backwards. So it's like the car is driving without them, and they're driving the car, you know, looking out the rear window as if they're not really doing anything. And the idea we're trying to get across is that right now we're sort of drivers in a driverless car. Things are changing incredibly quickly. Lots of stuff that we never imagined would happen in our lifetimes is starting to become close. And with the title, we're just trying to convey both this sense of wonder at the future and also this sense of unease and lack of control, and other types of, you know, ways that we might react to this really strange future that we're entering into.
Now, you're not just speculating, though. I know from looking at the book and going through, you know, the complete book, you've been doing this and researching on this topic of technological advances for a number of years. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's very much correct. So Vivek, my co-author, and I have been involved in the technology area for over 20 years. He's launched a couple of startups, including one that went public, and he served as a research professor at a number of major institutions such as Duke and Carnegie Mellon. I myself was the technology editor of businessweek.com for a number of years and have since been very active in the technology landscape and all along researching and writing. So this book is really kind of the summation of decades of insights and decades of reading and watching, and really also just us starting to understand that, wow, this stuff is moving really quickly and it's going to get interesting.
And actually, we're going to find out why, because there's actually a lore or a theory later on you're going to tell us about why this moves so quickly. But just to give us an idea, I think you said in the book, if we're a little afraid of it, robots are actually much better drivers than humans. Is that right?
Absolutely. And so that's something where I very much am looking forward to a future where I don't have to drive and my kids don't have to drive. You know, if you look at car accidents, they're overwhelmingly caused by human beings, human error. Robots don't get sleepy, they don't drink and drive, they don't get tired, they don't check their phones, they don't try to text. You know, there were 2.4 million injuries in car accidents, traffic accidents in the U.S. in 2015, and 32,000 deaths, actually 35,000 total if you counted pedestrian deaths. And almost all of them would not have happened if robots had primarily been driving.
Someone gave me a good theory this week. I mentioned about this show in your book, and he said whenever people talk about that, he suggests them, next time you get to a traffic light, look at the driver in the car next to you. Would you rather have that person there or a robot? And it made a good point, and I said, you know, compared to most of the people I see next to me, I'd rather have the robot. I'd feel a lot safer. So I guess that's a way of having a little courage to go into the future.
Yeah, I think so. And it also is a nice way to start to think about the future in ways that maybe initially are scary, but when we actually dig in, the future will be different, but probably be a lot better. I mean, so robots, not only are they better drivers, but this will take cars off the streets. So in cities, for example, somewhere between 30% and 50% of the traffic is cars circling looking for parking. So those cars will be off the streets. In cities, for example, I believe you're outside New York City. So New York City, you know, you will no longer need parking garages because robot cars will drive around and around, and then they'll go park somewhere else outside of the city at night. So parking spaces will be converted to places to live. You'll have a lot less pollution. So I mean, as you start to look through all of these side effects, you can see some real positives. Now, there also will be some negatives. You know, millions and millions of people who drive for a living are going to lose their jobs. Probably mechanics will too. Auto parts stores, aftermarket auto parts companies, all sorts of folks like that, because the industry will certainly consolidate. So, I mean, there's always pluses and negatives as we move forward into the future. And that's not unusual. It's always been like that.
Now, you mentioned in your book, and I think the expression you use, we have one of two possible futures. It can either be Star Trek or Mad Max.
Yes.
And what does that mean?
No, everybody latches on to that. And that's a creation really of Vivek. And it's something that I think about a lot, too. I think I'm a little more optimistic than he is on some of these matters. What we're trying to say when we pose these two alternative futures is that with all of these technologies, there are pluses and minuses. And right now, we're at a critical stage where, as a society and as a group of people, we can probably influence and choose how these technologies play out, how they impact our lives, and what it means. So Mad Max, it's an extreme, but, you know, that's a dystopian society where there's still technology, but government has essentially failed. People are on their own. You know, the Star Trek is much more of a utopian society where there's lots of equality, beautiful technology, medical devices that save us, space travel, all sorts of things like that. I don't think we're trying to say that the extremes are really that extreme, but there are definitely some scenarios you can look at with modern technology that are a little scary, a little Mad Max-like. And I'll give you a specific example. So with the latest generation of gene sequencing equipment, we can probably sequence a human genome, entire human genome, for less than $200. And it should be down to $100 soon, and in 5 years, probably down to $20. So it's very easy, as we start to see a time where we get so much genetic data and are able to analyze it, that, you know, there may be really easy ways to identify, oh, you know, you're probably going to have a problem with alcohol abuse. Maybe you don't now, but you might. And it's a higher percentage. So how do we as a society make sure that those people don't get discriminated against because of something that's in their genes?
Now, something I read there in the book, and both good and bad, I guess, you say we're going to have a jobless economy, no privacy, and economic inequality. It looks like we go from high to low to good news to bad there.
Well, so two things about a jobless economy. There will still be jobs. You know, there just probably will be jobs that are very different than the ones we see now. And in the interim, because things are moving so quickly, we expect a whole bunch of jobs to disappear, millions and millions of jobs. And you're seeing that now already. I mean, not en masse, but for example, jobs that are being done by robots, which might be surprising, are, for example, bartenders. We're starting to see robot bartenders pop up. Robots as sales associates in Japan. There's actually a retail chain that has deployed 1,000 humanoid robots to help people on the sales floor. Robots as shepherds. This is a test product, but in Australia, a farm technology government organization literally designed a robot shepherd to take care of cows and sheep. So almost any job you can imagine that requires more or less the same tasks over and over again and doesn't require a lot of strategy and deep creativity is potentially subject to being roboticized. Now, that future, though, chances are, because the robots will be faster, better, cheaper, and easier to maintain than a lot of the stuff that we're doing ourselves, we anticipate that future will be a very abundant one. There'll be lots of food. We'll all have power, water, shelter, and we probably will have a whole lot more time to do things that maybe we really enjoy more. Now, the question is, as a society, how do we evolve to accommodate a situation where our jobs are not our sense of identity like they are now?
Now, that's a great question. I want to bring that up next. But I think you're starting to get under everybody's skin a little bit, which is good. And that's why I want our audience to know our guest today is Alex Salkever. He is the author of The Driver in the Driverless Car, How Technology Choices Will Create the Future. And this future is very quick. This is coming. And some of it is obviously in motion already, and we're seeing more and more of it. Alex, where is the book available, and is there a website that we can jump on and learn more?
So thanks for asking that. I really appreciate it. The book is available at most major booksellers, Barnes & Noble, places like that. It's also available at Amazon, of course, Amazon.com, or as a Kindle. And probably the easiest place to find it is actually if you go to Amazon and search for Driver in the Driverless. And it's right there. And we'd love it if you decided you wanted to download it, take a read, and tell us what you think.
And I will guarantee you, if you read this book, you are going to be the most interesting person at that next cocktail party, picnic, barbecue, confirmation, wedding, bar mitzvah, whatever you go to. Everybody is going to either say, he, she is nuts. And then when you say, no, it's in this book and go read it yourself, it's like, oh, my gosh. Now, Alex, that you started to say something before, and that's where I want to go next. What is that going to do to us mentally? Like, most of us identify, what are you? I'm a teacher, I'm a plumber, I'm a policeman, I'm a crossing guard. We identify ourselves with our job, our profession, and what we do. If that goes away from us, are we just going to get into a lot of trouble, like kids standing on the corner? I mean, really, what's going to happen?
I think that's really an open question right now, and that's one of the big unknowns. You know, will we become, as a society, a place where it's okay to say I am a painter, and no, that's not actually how I earn my living, but that's how I spend my time. You know, or for example, something like you know, I am a software designer, but I don't actually sell any products. It's just something that I spend my time doing. So I am hopeful that this will actually give us a lot more mental space to do things that we love to do, and in that same way, usher in a new era of creativity and, you know, in just a completely different way of being human, where the 9-to-5 no longer becomes a 9-to-5. Now, granted, lots of people will still work. The jobless future is not going to be completely jobless. But it may be that more people don't work, and certainly over the next 20 to 30 years, we're going to find out pretty quickly what's going to happen in that regard.
Now, there's a law or a theory in your book that you talk about, which I think kind of is the overview of all this. It's something called Moore's Law. Am I correct?
Yes, that's absolutely correct.
Now, can you tell us? I wasn't familiar with this, and I'm sure our audience isn't. So what does that have to do with all this technology?
It's a great question, and it is a fundamental concept. Moore's Law isn't actually a physical law. What it is it's a rough calculation that the power of computing will essentially double every 18 months and the price will drop in half. So
Wait. 18 months, that's a year and a half.
That's correct.
It's going to double in a year and a half?
Roughly correct.
And the next time it doubles again in the next year and a half?
Exactly.
That's pretty fast, isn't it?
And so what you're seeing is an exponential development scale. And that's why when you look back at the moon landers back in the 1960s, the computers that ran those were actually far less powerful than our smartphones today. And our smartphones in about 20 years will have the equivalent power, computing power of an entire human brain, because all of this is accelerating so quickly. But this drives lots of other secondary developments, because under all of this is the fact that computing is getting smaller, cheaper, and faster at a ridiculous rate. So you start to see other things happen, like robots, for example. And people have been talking about robots for years and years, I mean decades. What robots really lacked before, though, was sufficient computing power and sufficient onboard capabilities to do the kind of things that we dreamed robots could do. You know, climb stairs, jump over objects, drive cars, you know, or even simple things like fold laundry, which is still hard for robots, but now they can do it. They never could have done it 20 years ago. That capability and the growth of those capabilities is a function of the fact that we can put a whole lot more computing power in those robots, and also something else called artificial intelligence, which means that computers can finally start to think much more like the human mind, not directly, but in ways that can simulate how human minds think and therefore solve problems in the world that were previously impossible for robots to solve. And I can give you a very specific example of this. Probably about, I think it was last year sometime, there was a big bunch of news stories about how a Google computer called DeepMind had defeated one of the world's foremost Go players.